Grace, mercy, and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
Our Lord Jesus Christ said, the first commandment is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is the only Lord. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: Love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandment greater than these. On these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Amen. Lord, have mercy. And so let's join in the following confession. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy upon us, pardon and deliver us from all our sins, confirm and strengthen us in all goodness, and keep us in life eternal through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
You are the vine, we are the branches, keep us abiding in you. You are the vine, we are the branches, keep us abiding in you. Then we'll grow in your love, and we'll go in your name, that the world will surely know that you have power to heal and to save. You are the vine, we are the branches, keep us abiding in you. You are the vine, we are the branches, keep us abiding in you. Then we'll grow in your love, and we'll go in your name, that the surely know that you have power to heal and to save. The branches, keep us abiding in you. You are the vine, we are the branches, keep us abiding.
John chapter 15, beginning to read at verse 1. I am the true vine, and my Father is the gardener. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit. while every branch that does bear fruit he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. You're already clean because of the word I've spoken to you. Remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you're like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is to my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourself to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you'll remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. This is the word of the Lord. It's amazing to see what different people think following God should involve, what the spiritual life is about. There are so many different options. For example, let me tell you about a man called Simeon Stylites. Simeon was a Syrian monk who lived in the 5th century near Aleppo, which of course has seen much violence in recent years and where Christians have gone through a huge amount of persecution. Now, in his quest to live a God-centered life, Simeon built a pillar 60 feet high in the middle of the desert, and it was on a 3-foot platform at the top of that pillar that Simeon stayed. Any guesses how long for? 37 years. A ladder enabled disciples to take him food and remove his waste. Now, just imagine if one day I got out a ladder and sat at the top of the tower of St. Nicholas Church and then declared that I was going to stay there for the rest of my life in order to get to know God better. I'm not sure who'd be bringing me up meals. It was not comfortable. Simeon bound himself to the pillar by a rope. The rope became embedded in his flesh, which was putrefied and stank and teemed with worms. Apparently, he picked up the worms that fell from his sores and replaced them, saying to them, "Eat what God has given you." Now, this is certainly one very extreme example of a way some people chose to follow God by cutting themselves off from others and the rest of the world. Well, I'm not asking you to judge what he did, but as Christians, we must ask ourselves the very important question, what is it to live spiritually? Should we cut ourselves off from the sinful world around us? Or at the other extreme, does it actually matter what we do at all? The Bible makes it clear that Christianity doesn't depend on people doing good deeds, but on God's mercy and forgiveness. So if this is true, if being a Christian doesn't depend on our goodness, then does it matter what we do in life at all? Well, John chapter 15 says that the way we live our lives matters a great deal. We are to remain in Jesus. So let's take a deeper look at the first part of this chapter and see what it means to remain in Jesus. Now, if you look down at the first part of the chapter, you'll see Jesus is using the imagery of a vine. Jesus is making some use of Old Testament imagery, which is used very clearly in Psalm 80. Now, in that psalm, we see that the picture of a great vine is used to describe God's people, who God brought out of slavery in Egypt and planted in the promised land of Cana, where the people of God prospered and flourished. But if you know the story of the Old Testament, then you will know that things went from bad to worse. People rebelled against God, and as a result, he punished them. And in verses 12 to 16 of the psalm, the vine is attacked. The vine is all but destroyed. But the psalm does end with a hint of hope. In verse 17, we read, "Let your hand rest on the man at your right hand and the Son of Man you have raised up for yourself. Then we will not turn away from you. Revive us and we will call upon your name. Restore us, Lord God Almighty. Make your face shine on us that we may be saved." When Jesus makes this claim, "I am the true vine," the claim he is making is enormous. He is claiming to be the true vine of God's people. He is the promised rescuer, the Son of Man, who is restoring God's people. What's even more amazing is the way in which the disciples have come to join the vine. John chapter 15, verse 3. You have been made clean already by the teaching I have given you. So how do the disciples come to join the vine? Well, through the word of God. That word that Jesus spoke to them. You can't do anything. You can't earn your way on this vine. You must let Jesus humbly serve you by cleaning you. You see, if we accept this message, the message of the good news about Jesus, if we accept Jesus' word, then just like the disciples, we will be clean and be part of the true vine of God's people. But Jesus says that once you join the vine, things don't just cease to happen. Jesus warns us that we must remain in the vine. So let's take a closer look at Jesus' warning. Jesus makes it very clear that it is vital for the branches to remain in him, absolutely vital. If they don't remain, then they'll become useless branches, unable to bear fruit, and will be treated as such. They'll be cut off, verse 2, and thrown into the fire, verse 6, John chapter 15. It's at this point that we start to panic and ask the question, how? Okay, I see it's vital to remain in Jesus, but how do I do this? Well, the brilliant thing is that God's word doesn't leave us in the dark. Jesus goes on to explain in verses 9 and 10. We are to remain in Jesus' love. How do we do this? By obeying his commands. Again, we're at a point of panic. What will it mean for me to obey Jesus? Will I have to do what Simeon Stylites did and live up a 60-foot platform? Well, fortunately, the answer is no. Jesus goes on to explain exactly what it is to be obedient to him. My command is this, love one another as I have loved you. This is what it means to be obedient to Jesus, to love one another the way he loved us. Now, how did Jesus love us? What did Jesus do that reveals his ultimate love? Well, of course, he laid down his life. He sacrificed everything for our spiritual good. So how are we doing? It's a very challenging passage. But if we're not going to allow God's word to change us, then there's no point in reading it, is there? Or let's take a deeper look at Jesus' commands and see what we're doing. As we gather, perhaps to take communion, we recognize that he took on all our guilt, all that is evil in us. He took that upon himself when he died in our place. That's how he loved us, by sacrificing everything. Now, do we love others in this way? Do we sacrifice everything for their spiritual good? Do we long to see others coming to faith? Do we think how we can move them on in their Christian lives? Surely that's the vicar's job, or the reader's job, or the house group leader's job. No, according to Jesus, it's every Christian's job. We are called to help one another. Do you pray for opportunities to love your brothers and sisters? Do you look for ways in which to make them feel welcome? We're about each other's spiritual good and doing everything possible to help one another. Jesus goes on in verses 14 to 16 of John 15 to call us his friends. We're his friends because he involves us in what he's doing. It's amazing that he can call us friends. Do we behave like his friend? After the amazing mercy that he's shown us in bringing us into the vine, as the Father has loved me, so I've loved you. Now remain in my love. If you obey my commands, you'll remain in my love, just as I have obeyed my Father's commands and remain in his love. I've told you this so that my joy may be in you and your joy may be complete. The good news is that to be spiritual, to be the people God would have us be, we're not to stand on the top of a pole or strap ourselves to the tower of the church. The bad news, or perhaps I should say the even better news, is that God does demand that we do something, and that is by following his example, to love one another. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for this very challenging passage, but a challenge which also reminds us of your great love for us. Lord, may that be the motivation, your love for us, that we might reach out in love towards one another and love as you loved us. For we ask this in your name. Amen.
I am the vine, and you are the branches. Live in me, and you will never die. I am the vine, my Father is the keeper. Come to me. Let the Spirit bring you life. Like a tree planted by the living water, to stretch its roots into the living stream. You will show no distress in the heat of the drought, but still bear fruit and and my Father is the keeper. Come to me, let the Spirit bring you
believe and trust in God the Father, source of all being and life, the one for whom we exist. Do you believe and trust in God the Son, who took our human nature, died for us, and rose again? Do you believe and trust in God the Holy Spirit, who gives life to the people of God and makes Christ known in the world? This is the faith of the Church. This is our faith. We believe and trust in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. We just take a few moments now to bring before God anything that we particularly want to pray for today. and we say together the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and for ever. Amen.
My song is love unknown. My Savior's love to me, love to the lovely shone that they might lovely be. Oh, who am I that for my sake my Lord should take frail flesh and
May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace as you trust in him, so that you may overflow with hope by the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen.